time for joys and concerns, and I'm having my mic runners come up.
Janan,
yes.
I have a great joy. The great joy is this group of people. Holy moly. But I say that, and there's lots of room still in the bass section. So we have room. So
we have another row back here, too.
I don't know if I need this, but I'm John Dixon. Kathy and I celebrate 21 years this coming week. And I also have a concern. My brother, who's a minister out in California, got taken to the emergency room yesterday while he was leading a youth out retreat. So just prayers for Doug Dixon. So thank you.
Carol Franks, I have a joy, and that is that we had our socks and underwear drive for the school children. I was able to deliver 300 pairs of socks and underwear to different schools, and they're all very grateful. They said, we definitely have need of these, and so thank you very much.
I'm Martha Bradfield. And I have a student from Germany, Cora. She wasn't here today, but we just found out Friday that one of her friends from China, as an exchange student, has to go home tomorrow because her visa ran out. China didn't give her a long enough one for the whole year, so she might be able to come back in January and finish, but she has to go home tomorrow at 11.
I'm Val Fraley, and Les Fraley has had a pretty good week. He's starting to regain, his energy, not at for long periods of time, but he's starting to want to move around a little more, and so that's good. We've been to two doctor's appointments this week, and the first one, everything seemed to be going pretty well, but they want him not to leap into too much. And then the second one was the cardiologist. And the only issue, and Tana maybe will tell me more about this, but one of his legs is slightly larger than the other in his calf, and that indicates there could be some kind of a issue with the blood clots, but they're not anticipating anything. But they canceled the one test we were having and lined us up for a different one. And so hopefully that'll end up being nothing to worry about, but keep praying for him. Thank you.
I'm Marilyn Casey. I'm one of the Cunninghams, in case any of you remember Cunninghams being here. It is my great joy to be here today. I came for my 50th class reunion, and when my nephew and niece said they were going to come here today, I said, yes. So it is a very great joy to me to be here today. I got married in this church in 1968. So this church has lots of really good memories for me.
Yes, it's me again, Sue Slaughter. I mentioned that Barbara McBride is in the hospital. She is way too good on her low salt diet, so now her sodium is low, and they have to get her back in sync with that. So she'll be in the hospital for a few days at Platte Valley, and she's very bored. If anyone would like to just stop by and say hello, she'd love it. And the other thing is, it's so good to see April Stevens here today.
Yes.
April has been missing for a couple of years as she's gone through the trauma of her leg injury, but if you see her walking, she has a beautiful new prosthetic leg. So, welcome.
Hi, I'm Terry Myers. I have a couple of joys. Seems like only a couple of years ago that I was all excited because my girls were getting their learner's permits. And now this next Wednesday is their birthday, and Rachel's going to be 26, and Holly's going to be 28. Holy cow. I know I'm only 35, so I don't understand it either. But, so, yeah, wow. And my other joy is 2 weeks from today, while you guys are all sitting here, I'll be doing the Susan Komen walk downtown, and both girls were able to get the day off to come with me, and I think Ed is going to be here to go with me also. And one of the new boyfriends is going to go with us too. So that's not my new boyfriend. So just think of us in two Sundays when we go to do that too. Thank you.
I'm Vicki Geis Fraley, and we have a joy. Dad's last chemo treatment is on Friday. So that's 16 weeks of chemo done and celebrated and over. So yay. And then we do have a concern. My niece, mom and dad's granddaughter, has been in the hospital, in Children's Hospital. She's seven. She's had an infection behind her eye, and it's kind of been pushing on her eye, and they've been giving her lots of antibiotics. So her name is Serafina, if you keep her in your prayers. Thank you.
Microphone's going around. Many of you have graciously been praying for my father, who went into the hospital this past week with a GI bleed, and they lived 2 hours from the hospital they needed to take him to, so he was 2 hours from home and 4 hours from us, and so that was stressful, and I really appreciate and covet your prayers. He's now home and doing better, and continuing to look into treatment options, but I just really appreciate and covet your prayers for him.
Pam Matheson called me this morning just before I came to choir to tell me that her mother had passed away yesterday, Ella Heitman. Some of the old timers will remember Ella when she was a member of this church.
Deb Friedholm, and I just want to lift up the people in the East Coast right now that are having the problems with the hurricane, and we just need to all keep them in our mind. I mean, because we remember what it was like 5 years ago when we had minor flooding. They're having major flooding, so let's keep them all in our prayers.
Any more joy or concerns?
I have a joy. Our volleyball team won another game and lost another game, so we're still tying games, so let's keep that up. Second game.
We have been praying for a friend of mine from my youth group days, Chris Dobson. I received word from his mother this week that he did pass away on Monday, far too young, and his fiance and his young son and family, of course, are heartbroken. So keep the Dobsons and Carrie in your prayers, please. And we also received word on Friday that Brian Willard, Bev Willard's son, passed away. And we will be hosting his services here on Friday at 10 o'clock. So lift the Willards up, as we just lost Deb this past spring. So to lose Brian now so soon is quite a trauma for the family. So keep the Willards in your prayers.
Let's go ahead and do the
Gracious and loving God, we come before you in the powerful and precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Lord, we are excited with the new song that you give us to sing each and every day. We are grateful for the opportunity to sing your praise wherever we go, to share of your love and grace, partake in your and mercy, to be the hands and feet of your Son Jesus Christ in this world. Lord, we are humbled to bring our prayers before you today. We're excited about the start of a new season, about milestones and opportunities for ministry. We're so overwhelmed by the gracious, generous hearts and the loving prayers that come from this body of Christ. We're so grateful for your healing presence, for your comforting Holy Spirit in the midst of all of life's ups and downs. Thankful for the opportunities for homecoming. And we ask for comfort in knowing that not everyone comes. But we know that the prayers that we have lifted up here have reached to the heavens and make it to you faster than we can even say them. We know that you know our needs long before we would dare ask. And yet, Lord, today we come before you to ask that you would be present with us, not just here in this place, but that we would feel you in our everyday lives, guiding our discernment, revealing to us each and every step as we keep our eyes forever on the light of your Son. Lord, it is in his name that we bring these prayers before you. He's the one who taught us how to live. He's the one who showed us how to love. And he's the one who brings us together in prayer as we now say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Our prayer response hymn is, O Spirit of the Living God, it's hymn number 539. Let us join our voices together in song.
Thank you. 2715, and then the and the facts of the that's page 5. Judging others. Do not judge so that you may not be judged. For with the judgment you make, you will be judged. And the measure you give will be the measure you get. Why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye? Or how can you say to your neighbor, let us take the speck out of your eye, while the log is in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. The power of God and the people of God.
Well, grace be yours and peace from Jesus Christ our Lord. I want to invite you to grab a hold of your Bibles, if you haven't already, and open them to that Sermon on the Mount in chapter 7. We'll dig into there. We're also going to do some Bible flipping. That's, you know, you're used to that by now if you've been around here much. And if you didn't bring your Bible with you, that's all right. We've got you covered. There are Bibles in the pew back right there in front of you. So if you want to grab a copy of God's Word and see that. We even take digital stuff. One of these days we're going to invent the add-on to the app so that, you know, I can get that page flipping sound. You know, that wonderful sound that's music to a pastor's ear as you turn those little thin pages of your Bible. But swiping is okay. We're okay with swiping. As we jump into the second week of this series we're calling Pursuit of Holiness, I just want to kind of remind us a little bit about where we were last week. See, I believe that the enemy of God has mobilized the influence of this world to manipulate God's people. To manipulate God's people into downplaying or even denying essential elements of our identity as followers of Jesus Christ. I think he's pulled out his whole bag of tricks to try and get us to turn away from things that are at our core. Okay? And we talked a little bit about this last week. We saw it in the midst of our discussion about holiness and how nervous we can get when we start talking about you and I as being holy. We have no problem with God being holy. Right? I hope not. We have no problem with the Bible even being referred to as holy in most cases, but when we start claiming that for ourselves, we get a little uneasy about that. But the truth is that God calls us to be holy. God calls us to be holy, and the enemy has tricked us into turning away from that critical element of our identity. Why? Why has the enemy done this? Well, it's very simple. God has already won. There we go. That's a great spot for an amen. You ready? You want to participate? Okay. You ready? Here we go. I'll tee it up for you again. Ready? God has already won. That's the truth right there, and you got to take that truth to the bank, because, see, God has already won, which means the only thing the enemy can do is trick us into giving up what is already ours. The only thing the enemy can do to beat us is to trick us into thinking that we're not who God says we are. That's why the enemy pulls out this bag of tricks. That's why this tool is so devastating to the people of God. You see, here's how it goes. You see, the enemy targets an essential part of our identity as children of God. Last week was holiness. Okay? And he uses the world to criticize that part of our identity, recognizing that some associated with the church, maybe even most or all of us at one time or another, warrant such criticism. We'll get there in a second. The result of this criticism, though, is that the church hides or modifies or denies or even abandons that critical piece of who we are in Christ, and thereby stripping the children of God of all of our power to manifest the kingdom of God. When the enemy can get us to turn away from who we are, he can strip us of our power. In fact, we surrender the power that we have to manifest the kingdom of God in this world. Now, Satan, like I said, has managed to use that tool against us in a variety of ways, and like I said last week, we talked about holiness. Well, this week we're going to talk about something that makes us probably even more a little queasy, and that is judgment. Judgment. Today's message is judging judgmentalism, a word that my computer doesn't even recognize as a word, which is super fun. We're creating English language together, okay? Judgmentalism. We're judging judgmentalism. First, we want to establish that judgment is an essential part of the Christian character and identity. Okay, that's our first step. That's the first step. And some of you might be thinking, gosh, that doesn't sound very Christian to be judging, right? Judgment doesn't seem like it should be an essential part of our Christian character, but I beg to differ. I beg to differ. And I want us to flip over to 1 Corinthians. We're going to hear what Paul has to say about this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, I told you we were going to do some Bible flipping, so keep your finger in Matthew 7. Okay, but 1 Corinthians chapter 6, Paul is writing to a church that we can all praise God is as big a mess as any church can be, right? The Corinthian church is always a mess, and Paul is constantly correcting their mess and trying to teach us, which means that no matter what mess we're in, we can draw inspiration from the correction that Paul brings to the Corinthians. And in chapter 6, he says, when any of you has a grievance against another, do you dare take it to court before the unrighteous instead of taking it before the saints? Quick reminder, when Paul refers to the saints, he's not talking about a bunch of holy dead people, okay? When Paul refers to the saints, he's talking about the followers of Jesus Christ. By the way, that's you and me, okay? So when he says the saints, think you and me. Y'all on board? Everybody with me? Okay. So he says, why, if you have a grievance against one another, do you dare take it to the court before the unrighteous instead of taking it before the saints? Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world is to be judged by you, are you incompetent to try trivial cases? Do you not know that we are to judge angels, to say nothing of ordinary matters? If you have ordinary cases, then do you appoint as judges those who have no standing in the church? I say this to your shame. Can it be that there is no one among you wise enough to decide between one believer and another? Did you hear it? Paul is very plain, and it's very strange to hear, but Paul says that we, the saints, you and me, will judge the world, everything from angels to ordinary. You follow me? That's what Paul says the children of God, the saints, the followers of Jesus Christ are called to do. We are called to judge. Now, in the context here, these folks in Corinth are taking their squabbles before civil courts to be decided. It would be sort of like if we got together and we decided that we were going to have a potluck and no one could decide who was going to bring the hot dish and the dessert. And instead of working it out together, we took it before a civil judge who had no connection to the church and no profession of faith to Christ and said, who should bring dessert and who should bring the hot dish? I have the best 9x13 hot plate dish around. I should be the one to bring it, right? You didn't find that as funny as I thought it was. Got a couple of laughs from the choir, right? They're trying to keep me on the good side, right? But do you understand what that is? They were settling their squabbles among themselves rather than going to each other and doing what God has called them to do, to judge the world, everything from angels to the ordinary. They're trying to hash it out in the courts. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? And yet, in the midst of that is this nugget that Paul says, we are to judge the world. Now, that makes us a little uncomfortable, doesn't it? We are to judge the world. But then, look back at the passage that Betty read for us today. At the very end, that last verse, verse 5, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. Jesus doesn't say, take the log out of your own eye and ignore your neighbor. Jesus says, you might see the speck in their eye, but you probably better take the log out of yours before helping the neighbor. But there, you see, it isn't an excuse to not do anything and an excuse to just let whatever go. It's an invitation to examine self before you take that same examination to others. Jesus commands us to first take that log out of our own eye before we look for the speck in our neighbor's. Now, hopefully by now you believe me that judgment in certain situations, in certain frames of doing it, are an essential part of our identity as Christians, as followers of Jesus. Let's take a look at how the enemy targets this part of our identity. And we don't have to look any farther than the beginning of verse 5, when Jesus says, "You hypocrite. You hypocrite. Let me take the speck out of your eye while the log is in your own eye. You hypocrite," he says. We see this hypocrisy as a charge leveled against Christians everywhere, against absolutely everyone. We see it every time, and it tragically wounds the church every time this happens, when a prominent Christian leader falls prey to the very sins they've preached against their entire career. You've seen the stories. They make it to the front page every time, because you see some preacher who rails against this sin or that sin, and the next thing you know, they have this secret that comes to light, that they've been engaged in it the whole time. Maybe you could think of somebody. Maybe not, but they're there. Maybe you've experienced the failure of a Christian leader in your own life and said, "I can't possibly follow them. They're hypocrites." The Barna Group published a study in a book called Unchristian. It was reported that 9 out of 10 young people view Christians as judgmental. I think we might have hit the nerve there, haven't we? But 9 out of 10 young people think Christians are judgmental. And here I am telling you that judgment is a critical part of our identity in Christ. And when we're viewed by 9 out of 10 young people as judgmental, and they read the beginning of chapter 7, where Jesus says clearly, "Do not judge so that you may not be judged," is it any wonder that we're seen as hypocritical? Is it any wonder that we shy away from this idea of judgment? Now, certainly there are reasons and examples. This is that place when we talk about the fact that there are people associated with the church, there are you and I, who have fallen short of the glory of God in our attempting to be disciples of Jesus Christ, where we have demonstrated hypocrisy, for sure. In fact, there are times when we have taken what is a core part of our identity as judgment, and we have turned it into judgmentalism and turned it on people in bad ways. I think we could all probably stand up and say, at some point in our lives, we could have been leveled with the charge of hypocrite that Jesus levels, that we'd overlooked the log in our own eye in an attempt to help someone with a speck. They're there for sure. But that's why the world's criticism is so effective. You know what? We talked about this last week, that the criticism that hurts us the most is the one that has that kernel of truth. You ever experienced that, when somebody levels some criticism at you that's way out there and has absolutely nothing to do with you, and it's so much easier to just want to let them sort of roll off? Well, that's not me at all. But when you get that criticism, it has that kernel of truth. I don't know about you, but that just eats at me. It eats at me. And so when the world levels this charge of hypocrisy on the church, this charge of hypocrisy on me, not just as a leader, but as a follower of Jesus Christ, I know how I have failed. I have seen leaders fail. I have seen people associated with the church fail in this issue of judgment. And so I wonder, are they right? What is our Christian response then to this judgment? Well, we marginalize or even deny this element of our identity entirely. One of my great friends and colleagues, Bob Kaler, is the pastor down in Monument at the Tri-Lakes United Methodist Church, and he says, at best we've responded with shamed silence, and at worst we've adapted, even gutted, our theology to avoid judgment at all. We avoid having judgment because we don't want to be seen as hypocritical, judgmental followers of Jesus. This is not a new thing, by the way. This is not a millennial problem, okay? All right? There's no leveling it at the young people, okay? This isn't, even though the 9 out of 10 young people have, view the church as judgmental, okay? Christians as judgmental. This isn't a new thing, right? Richard Niebuhr in 1938. Think about that, 1938. Richard Niebuhr in 1938 said, one of the problems is we have a God without wrath brought to people without sin into a kingdom without judgment through ministrations of Christ without a cross. We have gutted our theology. We have gutted our faith in God because we don't want to appear to be judgmental. The criticism has worked. We have laid down any and all right we have to discerning right from wrong by the power of the Holy Spirit. But we are called to, as Paul says, we are called to judge the world, everything from angels to the ordinary. We cannot preach that there is a God without wrath, brought to people without sin, into kingdom without judgment, through ministrations of Christ without a cross. We have to recognize that we fall short, that we're not perfect, but that God calls us to be better. So we have to distinguish between two very different kinds of meaning when it comes to the word judgment, right? There is clearly judgment that's not a good plan for any of us, right? Judgment that falls into judgmentalism is clearly not where we need to be. That's not where God calls us to be. So we need to distinguish between these two meanings that come out of the sort of ambiguous Greek and English forms of judgment. New Testament scholar F.F. Bruce puts it this way, it may mean exercising a proper discernment. Or it might mean sitting in judgment on people or even condemning them. I think it's pretty clear to us as people of faith which one we want to be in. Right? We want clear and proper discernment by the power of the Holy Spirit, not judging or condemning others. We've got to take care of the log before we can look at the speck. We need proper discernment. That's the judgment that we need. We need to have the relationship with God that allows us to see things as God sees them and to be able to communicate what God sees in love. So how do we exercise this good judgment in discernment while avoiding judgmentalism? Isn't that the question of the day? Isn't that really the heavy lifting for us? How do we do that? How do we get there? How do we exercise this good judgment, this discernment by the power of the Holy Spirit, and avoid sliding into judgmentalism? Well, Bob Kaler was gracious enough to share with me his thoughts about it, and they were so incredible. They were mined so clearly from Scripture that I'd like to share them with you. He outlines 5 steps. 5 steps to accomplishing this, okay? The first step, are you ready? All you note takers out there love these outline kind of sermons, don't you? So the first step is that we have to recognize the way we judge others is the way that God will judge us. Let me just say that one more time. We have to recognize that the way we judge other people is the way God says He will judge us. Look at the very first verse from our reading today. Do not judge so that you may not be judged. For with the judgment you make, you will be judged. And the measure you give will be the measure you get. The measure you give will be the measure you get. The judgments that you level on other people create the yardstick by which you will be measured. You follow me? Okay? Which is why Jesus then goes on to say, take the log out of your own eye before you go for the speck in someone else's. It's not so you can see better. It's because if you're willing to recognize the log in your eye, your measuring stick will be a lot more gracious to the person with the speck. You follow me? And when that happens, judgmentalism is out the window. We have to recognize the way that we judge others will be the way God will judge us. We are all sinners needing grace and mercy. Now that might not sound like good news, but the good news comes in recognizing our need for that mercy and realizing God has already provided it. God has already provided it. Bob lifts up this awesome quote from theologian Greg Boyd, the Christian's job is to agree with God that every person you meet was worth Jesus dying for. Let me just say that one more time so it settles on your heart because it's so profound. The Christian's job is to agree with God that every person you meet was worth dying for. You meet somebody on the street, you have no idea who they are, what they've done, what they will do. Your job as a Christian is to agree with God because God has already said it in the person of Jesus Christ. Your job is to agree with God that every person you meet, including the one right before you, is worth Jesus dying for. When we feel ourselves being pulled into that judgmental bandwagon, we need only ask, what if God thinks about me the way I think about others? Boy, that is a thought that will stop you in your tracks. If you're not writing stuff down, write that down. Okay? What if God thinks about me the way I think about others? Seriously. You've heard the golden rule, right? The golden rule, what is it? We've all heard it before. Mom taught us, grandma taught us. Okay? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you, right? And we often focus on the do unto others first, right? As you would have them do unto you. Right? Treat people how you want to be treated, right? That's the shorthand for it, right? But what about this? Treat people or do unto others as you would want God to do unto you. Boy, that sobers you right up, doesn't it? It's really hard to be judgmental when you're thinking about how God's thinking about you. So we have to recognize that how we will be judged, or how we judge, is how God will judge us. Step two is we have to conduct a rigorous self-examination. And by rigorous, I mean rigorous self-examination, right? As disciples of Jesus Christ, we have to be more aware of how we fall short of the glory of God than about how others do. That's really critical for us, okay? That's really critical for us. And check this out. In our passage today, why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye? What Jesus is saying is, your faults are glaring to you, and yet you miss them. If you're doing rigorous self-examination, it's not like these things are going to be hard to find. Rigorous self-examination. Flip over to 1 John for me. There's a passage in 1 John we just need to commit to memory here. 1 John, you get to Revelation, you've gone too far. Back up a few books. You'll make it. 1 John 1, we have this beautiful passage. 1 John 1, 8 says this. He says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from our all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. We have to be able to know our sins better than we know someone else's. And yet it's so much easier to major in someone else's shortcomings, right? It hurts a whole lot less to notice the way other people fall short and to kind of gloss over what Paul says when we all fall short of the glory of God. So to avoid entering judgmentalism, we have to turn the righteous and honorable discernment of judgment on ourselves. Where do I fall short? Not let me know where this person falls short. Where do I fall short? Because then we can see more clearly. Then we can go more prayerfully into the judgment of others. Well, then there's this, step three. So step one was we have to recognize we'll be measured by the yardstick that we create, right? The second is we have to perform rigorous self-examination. Third, we confront others with humility and grace. Those are two very important terms. If you've gone over yourself with that fine-tooth comb and you recognize each and every place you fall short of the glory of God, then you can go prayerfully with humility and grace to those who might need your help with their speck. And Jesus gives us this beautiful picture of how this is supposed to go in Matthew 18, a little bit later in Matthew. If you go to Matthew 18, verse 15, we have this teaching. He says, if another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. First step, direct contact in private. Okay? This is not, I'm going to post a litany of your sins on Facebook. You follow me? This is, go to the person directly in private and talk to them. And how hard that can be. How hard that can be to confront things directly. One-on-one. Not roping in other people to confirm what you think is true. Going to them one-on-one and saying, I'm seeing something in your life I don't think needs to be there. Can we talk about that? Can we sit down for coffee one-on-one, alone, just the two of us? If a member listens to you, then you have regained that one. I want to point out that the member listens to you doesn't necessarily mean that the member agrees with you. You follow me? You might take something to somebody one-on-one, and they might explain themselves, and you could come away going, you know what? I didn't realize that about them. You could walk away from that. It doesn't say, go to them one-on-one, just the two of you alone, and if that member agrees with you and changes as you have discerned is true, it says, if the member listens to you, you have regained that one. You have regained that one. Going in with humility and grace means not necessarily going in expecting that there's no way you come out unchanged. You follow me on that? You go into a conversation with somebody and say, I really don't think this is of God, and I think we need to have a conversation about it. You might come away from that conversation going, I was wrong. I'm glad we had this conversation, because now I have peace about it. And you might come into the conversation with the other person saying, I was wrong. I think you're right. I think I need to work on that. And the Bible says, Jesus teaches that you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you. Okay, if your discernment is so right and there's no resolution, you take a couple extra people with you, and this is Jesus' picture of an intervention, right? Take a few people with you. See if you can make some sense of it. So that the word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. That's part of the law at the time. Two or three witnesses confirmed something, right? And if the member refuses to listen to them, then tell it to the church. Uh-oh. We don't like that, do we? That's getting in your living room right there. If he still isn't listening and refuses to see and the discernment is clear, then bring it before the church. Well, and if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be thrown out and tarred and feathered, right? You don't think that's what it says? Well, I hope you have a copy in your God's Word, because I'm telling you what, that's not what it says. Right? It says, let such a one be to you as the Gentile and the tax collector. And I would invite you to think, before you start wondering how to treat the Gentile and the tax collector, to just take some time and read about how Jesus treated Gentiles and tax collectors. He didn't approve of what they did, but he stayed connected, hoping for reconciliation. He still loved them. He still showed his love for them. He still associated. He still remained connected with people, even in the worst of circumstances. No matter what happens, we continue to love them. At no point is your judgment ever going to lead you into not loving somebody if you remain following Jesus Christ. You hear me? At no point is, if your judgment is leading you to not love somebody, you might need to get some space. I hear you on that. Okay, we all need some space sometimes. You might need to just separate for a bit and say, we need to go to our own corners, or I'm going to say something that's not going to be very good. Okay? But the truth is that if any of your judgment is leading you to not love that person, then you need to check your own heart. We need to check our own heart. Because we must love above all else, even in the midst of conflict. Then there's this. Step number four, seek restoration and reconciliation. Steps three and four are actually about helping the neighbor with the speck, in the proper order, of course, having dealt with your own lawn. That's what these are all about. Seeking restoration and reconciliation, and we do this from the position of knowing that God has done far more than we could have ever dreamt to find restoration and reconciliation with us through Jesus' death on the cross. We come from that place of knowing that God has found me. God left the 99 to find me. God left that 99 to find you. And we are called to find the lost and restore through reconciliation. That's the key. That should be our goal always. That's why love can never be out of the equation. Because even if we're in a conflict, even if we disagree, even if we can't hold hands in the pew, we are still to love each other. Jesus says that there is rejoicing in heaven at one sinner who repents. One sinner who repents. Much more than the 99 who need no repentance, Jesus says. So our goal is always, when we judge, when judgment comes into play, when that Holy Spirit-led discernment is our goal and our task, ultimately, we are to aim for restoration and reconciliation. And then there's this, and this is the hard one for a lot of us, okay? This is a hard one. We leave ultimate judgment in the hands of God Almighty. We leave the ultimate judgment in the hands of someone else. If your judgment is leading you to declare condemnation over another, there couldn't be a clearer log in your eye. We leave ultimate judgment in the hands of God. We do not abandon our call to judge, to discern the right from wrong, but our job is not to ultimately judge and condemn, but to agree with God that every person you meet was worth Jesus dying for. A sin-soaked world will always see correction as judgmental. Okay? That's important for us to recognize. The sin-soaked world will always see any correction as judgmental, but we cannot allow that to force our abandonment of right and wrong. Instead, we are called to approach the world with the truth, grounded in humility, grace, and love, knowing that in my life, the most important restoration and forgiveness is that I have already received. We can extend that to each other. So we're judging judgmentalism as bad, but we're going to hang on to judgment. As the people of God, we are called to judge the world, angels to the ordinary. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we can do it in love and grace. Are you ready for your homework? Some of you look really nervous about the homework right now. Okay, so we got our Thirsty 30. We're continuing this March, right? Okay, I hope you all are doing this. This is our 30 minutes a day devoted to God, 10 minutes of Bible reading, 10 minutes of prayer, 10 minutes of worship. Okay, whatever you want to consider worship, K-Love, your favorite hymn, whatever it might be. Maybe you're practicing for the choir. We've got room in the back, I'm told. Okay, if you want to check that out. They can't sing, we got a bell choir. All right, we got you covered, all right? But anyway, 10 minutes of Bible reading, 10 minutes of prayer, 10 minutes of worship, 30 minutes to God each and every day. And while you're in that time of prayer this week, I want you to go to God and I want you to ask a very simple and yet a very difficult question. I want you to ask God to reveal a log that you have been overlooking. Just go to God and say, God, reveal a log in my life that I am overlooking, so that I can see you more clearly, so that I can know you more deeply. Okay? I think I should pray for you on that one. Shall we pray? All right, let's pray. Holy and gracious God, we are overwhelmed by your grace and mercy. When we stop to think about it, Lord, we are overcome with grief at the ways we have fallen short. And yet we are filled with a joy beyond imagine at knowing that you have already forgiven them. You've already welcomed us home, that the party has already started because we have turned and embraced new life in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, help us to find those logs so that we may help others with their specks with grace and humility. In Jesus' name we pray.
This morning, Pastor Joel gave the perfect introduction for offering time. Open your hearts, open your eyes, and ask God to reveal the log in your life. And then give from your substance to help remove the speck from others around you.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Lord, we thank you for these offerings that have come from the hearts of the people gathered here. We pray that these amounts might help us after we have found the logs in our own eyes to help in removing the specks in the world around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And as we make the transition from the worship in this place to the worship of our everyday lives, I want to remind you to join us for fellowship time, but also come forward if you have need for further prayer, and one of our wonderful Stephen ministers would love to pray with you. If you can't make it forward or you'd prefer, you can just stay where you're at and they will come and pray with you. And of course, before you leave today, make your way down to our prayer chapel and take part in Holy Communion on this Sunday morning. And now may we join together in our benediction song. Go out into this world not just thinking that every person you meet was worth God dying for, but knowing it and sharing it with them. Go in peace, for you are.